First, let me thank Axis for inviting me to join this conference. For me as a researcher, it is not on? It is. Okay, I'm sorry. So let me thank Axis for having me here on this conference. For me as a researcher, it's a really great opportunity not to share knowledge, but also to be inspired by the families and the other researchers and clinicians. So I'm here representing Trixie National Center of Expertise in the Netherlands, where researchers and clinicians work together to improve care for children and adults with sex chromosome trisomies. So I'm chief scientific officer responsible for the research. So I'm from clinical neurodevelopmental sciences at the university. I've been doing research for 15 years on these conditions, and it was about 3 years ago that we connected with the clinics, the treatment and expertise center, and the academic medical center to really have these, to work together in improving care and get the research where we want it to be. So this is just a screenshot of our website. We have lots of, we have a handbook, we have lots of brochures. We try to redirect families to other areas in the Netherlands. And this is just, it's in Dutch. I'm sorry, it's also a screenshot, but just to illustrate for you the range of brochures we have on top for children, for parents, for adults, but also for professionals, for teachers, for clinicians, and we post clinical recommendations and fact sheets. So we really want to bring the science and research to clinical practice and society. So when looking at the research, I noticed that lots of our efforts in research are going into learning about the physical and medical issues associated with these conditions. So I felt the responsibility to contribute and learn more about how having an extra X or Y chromosome may impact your brain development, cognitive development, and behavior. So our focus is really on neurobehavioral development. So we have seen several research cohorts. We started out with studying adults with XXY, and then we wanted to see the children. We saw 60 boys with XXY. Then we included also the girls. So we had 60 children with an extra X chromosome, both boys and girls. And now we kind of moved down in developmental stage and we look at children aged 1 to 6 year old. We are now at 70 children with these sex chromosome trisomies, but still counting because we are still in the middle of our research project. So I formulated a set of research aims, things we think are important in research. So the first one is to really look beyond behaviors. So neurobehavioral symptoms may arise from different underlying cognitive processes, and this is really very important for us to be able to understand why a subset of children show with these chromosome trisomies show behavioral symptoms, to really have a deeper understanding of the mechanisms, and also to be able to inform clinicians what to screen for, what to monitor, what to evaluate, to come up with a short list of things to check in these children, not that we expect it to be areas of vulnerability in all children, but we need to screen for. And also to be able to identify to identify very specific targets for support and intervention. So if we want to help or improve outcome, neurobehavioral outcome, what should we target in development? And that's why we really need to focus on these cognitive mechanisms. So we recently reviewed, I think it's very important to also, as a researcher, to reflect on what we already know, what already is out there in the literature, and to all evaluated and interpret. So we recently, just a couple months ago, published this review on neurocognitive functioning and risk for psychopathology in the trisomies. So we actually pulled all the data together that we have in terms of risk for autism spectrum disorder, ADHD, depression, anxiety, and to calculate average risk scores in these domains across the literature, and to come up with hypotheses in terms of what do we think are important cognitive mechanisms driving this risk, and we identified areas of language development, executive functioning, social cognition, emotion regulation that may help us understand these risks and to focus on in intervention. So this is the model we are working on right now, looking at very early development in children aged 1 to 6. So we look at lots of different aspects of neurocognition, including social cognition, executive functioning, language, various aspects of information processing, emotion regulation, and empathy to help us understand and predict the behavioral symptoms that we see in some of these children in terms of difficulties in social adaptation or emotional control, communication, autism symptoms or ADHD symptoms, and at the same time also take into account the environmental factors that influence these pathways. So we do collect data on behavior using questionnaires, parents inform us, but we also do very systematic observations. We code the behaviors that we see in children. And just looking at some of the data we have so far collected in the TRIXIE study, I listed the top 10 behavior observations of parents because we asked them, does your child currently have or in the past any of the following behaviors on a regular basis? And this is, it is a really long list that we asked, but this is the top 10 that parents indicated. So about half of the children, this is a group of 70 children with an extra XY chromosome, about half of the parents reported temper tantrums in their children. Shyness, short attention span, distractibility, being bothered by things touching him or her, like tags on clothing. Immaturity, resistance to change in routines, anxiety, poor eye contact, impulsiveness, moodiness. So this is really informing us as researchers what to target and what to have a better understanding of. And I think it kind of condenses in some important themes for me as a researcher to look more at emotional control, at social development and executive functioning. And it's kind of reassuring because that is what we are actually are focusing on right now in our research. So in understanding these mechanisms, we do a lot of cognitive testing. Most are computerized tests, but in the younger children, we do these types of tests. And this is actually my 7-year-old daughter participating in research also. Yeah, that's what happens when your mom is a researcher, right? Yeah. But now we also use lots of eye tracking to have a better understanding of social perception and executive function. I think this is an excellent way for us researchers to really study processes in very young children as well. We also study emotion regulation, and this is something that is difficult. It's not easy to grasp and to record or measure in children or in adults. So that's why we, for example, rely on having heart rate measurements, looking at arousal markers when we present children with unexpected events or in response to others or emotions of others, or we look at arousal when they are frustrated or in response to eye gaze. And we really are interested in how the arousal system responds in these situations that are all part of our daily life as well, right? Not only looking at arousal responses, but also looking at how children recover from those situations and how they get back to how they cope with these situations. So a second aim for us, or an important theme, is I think developmental perspective is key for us. So the behavioral phenotype is anchored in early neurocognitive development. And we know that our brain continues to develop well into our 20s or 30s. And we know that cognitive functions may become online later on in development. So this really helps us better understand if there's a growing into deficit, for example. What are early markers? What are early predictors of later development? And there may also be very specific presentation of the phenotype depending on age. So I think developmental perspective is key to understand vulnerability, but also key to optimize outcome, because we know that early intervention may impact this developmental outcome. So what do we know about early cognitive development in these sex chromosome trisomies? Well, we 2 weeks ago, our review study was accepted in Clinical Genetics, looking at reviewing neurocognitive functioning of children with these trisomies, and with the aim of identifying targets for early intervention to help push this field forwards in this direction. And it really identified the need for more studies focusing on executive function and emotion regulation and social cognition, in addition to intellectual functioning and language, what we already know more about. So this really triggered also the direction of research in our TRIXI center. So in 2016, we were funded by the Dutch government to really look at this early stage of development, 1 to 6 year olds. So we have children with the X and Y chromosome trisomies coming in a longitudinal study. So after 1 year, we reassess development of the children. The study is based at Leiden University, and it's in collaboration with all the academic medical centers in the Netherlands and in Belgium. So all their, the families they know are all referred to our study. And we also, I was very happy that Dr. Nicole Tartaglia accepted our invitation to also participate in the study and be a TRIXI partner site at the Children's Hospital in Denver. So we are still seeing families there, and if you're interested, Lisa Cordero is here and can tell you more about that. So we actually built a copy of our lab at the Children's Hospital so we could have international collaboration. So for us, it's this study hopefully also allows us to have to take some first steps in identifying early cognitive functioning and really how it predicts behavioral outcome over time in this early stage. So just to illustrate to you, we also took it a step further because I was very happy that Nicole invited me to also implement pieces of this eye tracking in the baby study, and just to illustrate to you what we can do and what we can already assess in very young children with eye tracking. Here is an example of what we evaluate in the young children. And these are really, I will just start the video, but this is really are the building blocks of social cognition in children, measuring intention prediction, the ability to predict intentions of others. So it's very basic, but might be very indicative of more complex processes later on in development. So this is what is presented to the children on the eye tracking, and we really look at what they are, how they perceive the situation. So we present this a couple times. So it's a hand grasping the yellow duck for a couple times. So this is, children need to learn that this individual has a preference. Then we swap toys, or we swap the direction of the hands, and then we actually do the assessment. Well, the hand stops, and we can use eye tracking to detect if the children can make a prediction what the hand will do. Will it grasp the yellow duck? Is it a preference of an individual to have this toy? So this is really basic building block of social perception and theory of mind, understanding the desires and intentions of others. So another research aims to look beyond the extra X chromosome. This is a study looking at the genetics of cognitive ability in 11,000 twin pairs, comparing monozygotic and dizygotic twins. It's not our work, but it's very important for us to realize that this showed that there's a genetic contribution of 50% to cognitive ability, but there's also another 50% of environmental influences impacting cognitive development. So yes, some individuals do have this extra X or Y chromosome, but there are also environmental influences. And this study also showed that this is especially true in childhood. So the contribution of environmental influences is bigger in childhood as compared to adulthood. So we need to focus on this early development, because then we can positively influence cognitive development. So we focus in the study also on a couple of environmental factors, because together it impacts the phenotype. We look at life events, we look at socioeconomic status, so opportunities to enrich the environment of the child. We look at parenting styles, at family functioning, to have a more close look at those interactions. And lastly, and related, we also aim to evaluate the effect of preventive intervention. We have one study, it's now in revision, looking at self-management training focusing on executive functioning and the impact in adults with XXY. And we do seem, it does seem to improve inhibitory control, and it reduces some of the neurobehavioral symptoms. But we are now, as part of TRIXIE, also looking at preventive intervention. It's only in the Netherlands, but we implement early stimulation of social-emotional development at the age of 3 to 8. It's a home-based DVD training program. It's daily for 4 days, for 5 days a week, 4 weeks long. I cannot tell specifically what program this is because we're in the middle of the study. I'm not allowed to. But we do pre and post measurements with eye tracking and social cognitive tests to see how this impacts the development of the children. And I think that it's important that such interventions are accessible for parents and not just for those who are referred or have a really significant clinical symptoms, but also for all the children that are out there and that might benefit from support. Okay, so we thank all participating families. And if you're still interested to contribute to this study, please contact the Extraordinary Kids Clinic. And here's my contact details if you want to get in touch with me after the conference. Thank you.